go fast through the slides. Some words before, we are from a backend as a service company, Appiomat, but we are trying to not make too much things about our own. We want to tell you the story, how we get here, how you can benefit from backend as a service. We will show you an app and how to integrate, and we will show you some Android code, how to integrate the backend. And finally, we will show you how we did in a project, and yeah, perhaps two marketing slides. We were really fast with that and warned you before, so you can close your eyes. So let's start in 2010. Who has was involved in app development in 2010? Okay. Who was involved in backend development in 2010? Oh, okay, quite a lot. So, who thought, I thought backend development was a pain, and I'll tell you why with the next slide. What we did in 2010, we had MySQL and Hibernate for the database and object mapping to the other layers. And we had proprietary protocols for the communication between the front end and the back end side. We defined our own things and pushed the data, pulled the data to the other side. We had our own servers for every app that we made. There were minimum two or three servers, the live system, something for staging and something for testing. We had administrators who were looking for all the servers. And if we started a new project, with MySQL we had those schemas and we have to define new schemas, but we copied some code, for example, for making push notifications or for imports or all these things. So that was a little bit copy paste. So yeah, that was a little bit pain, and was someone also involved in such pain? Perhaps not the same tools, was it? Yeah, raise hands. Yeah, okay, some guys. So we decided, perhaps to the next slide, we decided to make things easier, and we thought we couldn't be the only one. And who has heard of backend as a service until now? Who has? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So not too much. So let me introduce you that concept. What is backend as a service? These are the guys who founded the companies. You see two of them here and three others on the picture. All of us are involved in building apps minimum since 2009. I think Andreas started building apps, backends for apps in 2005. He was one of the guys where you can get a ticket in the Leipzig tram with your Java ME mobile phone. Really quite a lot of time since that. Okay. What is the requirements for a backend as a service? So first thing we wanted to prevent the developers from is all the server hassle, the things with setting up a Linux server, putting in the database there, dealing around with, I don't know, load balancers and all this stuff, and making Linux updates and I don't know. That's hosting included. All these things, if you have backend as a service, all these things are included, and probably you won't need that admin anymore. Next thing is protocol. No proprietary protocols. In the last years, REST has come to the is the standard protocol for such things, and normally you have a REST protocol as a if you're using a backend as a service. For creating, reading, and updating your data, and normally data is exchanged via JSON. SDK, and let me welcome Uli here. That's one thing that we've learned from him. He's a front-end developer, and what we've learned is that the guys in the front-end don't want to save things as key value pairs. They want to have the same model that we have on the server side. They want to have that also on the front end, and they don't want to save key values. And I've learned learned that, or we have learned that, and so we what we now do is we generate SDKs in the programming language of your front end. So we'll see that on Android. On the example, we generate, you define your backend data model, and we generate the SDK with the same data model built in there. A web-based dashboard. So yeah, what we could have done would be something like a Glyph's rich client, I don't know, or anything. You had those tools like MySQL, but we don't want all of that at the backend as a service. Everything should be accessible via a browser. So a web-based dashboard where you can also look at your data and edit your data. Everything should be in the browser. Out of the box modules, that was this copy and paste things that we always had in the apps. And what we now actually want is having modules like Facebook integration, importing data or exporting data. Making backups, all these in out-of-the-box modules that can be added to your backend with just one click. Yeah, and last thing on the top is server logic. You get a lot of things done with create, read, update, delete, and the REST protocol, but sometimes there are some use cases where you need some logic on the server. I'll give you some examples for that later, some of the backend as a service providers give you the possibility to add also a logic on the server side. That's the requirement for a backend as a service, from my opinion, a minimum. So now let's change over to Philip, and he will show you how it works if you're a developer and you would like to use backend as a service in an app.
Yeah. Because of the bad internet connection, I decided to show you only the hacking stuff in the video and not in the live demo. But I think it's also okay. Okay, what we do now? I think we can create today a simple task manager app for Android. I know there are a lot of, but it's a simple project and it's easy to understand. Okay, let's start with the backend stuff. You go here, you have to sign up for appiomat.com. So fill in username, okay, email, password, opa, and so on. Okay, you're redirected to login page and then login. So here we can create our app. Let's call it Task Manager or Femi Task Manager. And that's the name of the app. And let's add a description for better understanding. Okay. So now the app is created. And here you can see the app setup overview screen. Here you can add a new app, configure your app, also delete, deploy the app to our cloud. Copy modules from live to test, see your base URL and API key. Normally you don't need it when you use the SDKs, but you can also use the REST interface and then you need this information. And you can see the state of your app. Now it's undeployed. And you can also add modules. And modules are like push, XML import, export, Facebook, and so on. This Facebook module. Okay, but we don't need it. On the left side, you can see that we have three systems. We have a test system, a staging system, and a live system, and they are independent from each other. So, but you can copy your data from one to other and vice versa. Okay, let's do it on a live system. Now we switch to classity.app. Come on. Yeah. Okay. Here you can add your classes in object-oriented manner. Let's add a class called task. Okay. So this is the class called task. You have also some basic classes, or one basic class at the moment. You can see here, that's the member model. You always need a member model to authenticate, use resolver. And yeah, your username has a username, last name, and some basic basics. Okay, here you can set access rights for quad, also for create, write, read, update, delete. 2-3 roles, guest owner and user. You also can inheritance, like the normal object oriented. You can inherit from memory model at the moment, why there's no other class there. Okay, let's add an attribute. You have some attributes, I don't know if you see it. You have a map, image, normal string, numbers, data object, but we need in a moment only text object for our description. So add a name for description. You can also do a collection thing of that, but we need only one description at the moment. And we need a Boolean flag, but there's no Boolean, so we use number from 1 to 0. Okay, that's all. Now we have created a class called task with 2 attributes, description and done. And now let's deploy it to our cloud. Yeah, you can see it, you have to deploy it. So you deploy, and the warning is disappear. So now you are ready to download the SDKs and begin with developing your app. Here, this is the SDK tab. You can see the generated SDKs for all the languages that we are supported at the moment. That's Java, yeah. You can see Python, PHP, iOS, and Android. You can see some sample snippets where you can copy and paste it and test some things. And you can see an example of your generated map. It's simple Pojo with some convenience methods. Okay, let's download the SDK. Also was the internet not so fast, and it takes a while because it's generated SDK at the moment. But now, yeah, let's save the disk. Okay, so and now switch to our IDE. This is Eclipse, you know Eclipse. And on the left side, you can see the project which I prepared with some activities and some list adapters and so on. That's not the stuff that I would show you here. We are only interested in the SDK part, I think. But you all know how to develop Android lists and so on. Okay, let's unzip the package and copy or move the data from your download folder to the app. Yeah, that's all the 2 folders at the moment. There's also an RPMod folder in it. Come on. Okay, let's track it in the IDE to the source folder. Yeah, there. Okay, import. Okay, I will progression progress. Yes. So, yeah, you can see the new folder, the front folder. There are all the generated SDKs, they got all generated stuff in. And that's our the activities and list adapters. Okay, what we do now? Let's see it on the to-do list. Okay, what we do now is to configure our app with the backend. We add a data store object, we add a member model. The data store object is the connection to the backend. It does all the HTTP stuff and all the caching stuff for us. Okay, now the memo model is initialized. It's a username and password, and you configure the data store with this user day. Okay, let's download the user if there. I will move forward. So, here. Okay. Load me async. This is a convenience method also. I don't write any code at the moment. I don't write the message load me async for myself. It's from the SDK. And it's load the user credentials from the server. In a background thread, that's important in Android. You can also do load me on the main thread, but it's not allowed on Android, or it's not convenience. Okay, so let's delete this and do load me async in the background. And if you're background, you must be notified if the server request is finished, and we do this with a callback. And the callback has a method that you have to implement it. And here I implemented the message is done. And check if the exception unlike null. And if the exception occur on the server, I save the user first. Of course, there's no user credentials, and so the server says, yeah, I don't know it. Let's save it first. Okay, I save it. And there's also a callback method. And the next step is to download all the tasks. This is the get task method. We'll uncomment this for you. So, okay. And the marked section is where we download the tasks. Get task async is awesome convenience method, which has a callback, the get list callback, which you can see above. It's also a callback with a result list, which comes from server. And we also check here if exception is null, then all went okay. And we clear our list adapter, add objects if there are any, and notify the adapter that something has changed. Yeah, that's normal Android stuff. Okay. How we save now a new task, or how we add a new task to our backend and to our list. That's do we here in the menu handling. What we do is also save async on, we create a new task object here. That's also generated task. And we add a description, and it's not done yet, so we add null, zero. We add it to our list adapter. We notify the list adapter, and we call save async to put it on the server. Also callback method. Yeah, that's, let's check if the exception and show toast, and sonst else show successfully saved. Or successful saved, it's a typo. Okay, let's start the emulator. Here this is it's a really basic Android app. You have here on the left side a list, and on the right side a detail screen. Okay, let's add some stuff. The toast you can see successful saved, so the object was sent to the server and saved there successfully without any exception. And that's not a good name. Let's add a real task and save it again. Save is also an update the server decides. If the object is there, then update the object. If there are no object with this ID, then save it in the backend. Okay, that's one. Let's add another one. It's also saved successful. Okay. Check and dashboard if items are there. Save it. And now let's see if the objects are really on the server. So we go back to our dashboard, our AppUMI dashboard, and switch to the data tab here. And here you can see the task has two entries. This is a data editor of our dashboard. You can create also new objects, you can delete, and you of course can edit it. And now we have checked it, so we set it down to one. Okay. So now it's one. Go back to our emulator, start the app again. There are all true things. And here you can see there's a check mark. Also, it's really on the server, and it's callback also. Okay, that was what I would show you. And over again to Lutz.
Thanks. Yeah, that was a short introduction. We only showed you the basic things. You can do a lot more stuff with queries and make backend logic. But let me use the time for telling you about a project that we did. When we were not working at AppUMed, when we worked at the company that we worked before, there was a project, you can have a look at it, it's called CityKit. There is a website, an Android app, and iOS app. talking to the clients they had. Yeah, it was difficult clients as it's always. And I was the project manager. We didn't have any backend team at all at that time available for doing such stuff. And yeah, we discussed making things with Appiumat, and we did it. It was really a complex project. CityKit, yeah, let me tell you two words about it. Yeah, you can go in a city, have a look at that app, and can see which addresses, bakeries, whatever is around, which dates are on the schedule tonight, and which are offers that, I don't know, the bakery or the hotel is making, and which are deals that they make. So a lot of things to do, more than 30 classes in the data models. Everything was highly connected to each other. They had data before, more than 1,000 objects to import via CSV files. Yeah, and we had complexity that we had to do some server logic that was, for example, merging two accounts. So if you use the app, you don't have to put in your credentials. You can use it, save your favorites, and you can also do the same thing on the tablet and on the phone. And if you then say, okay, I want to sync those, I'll put in my email address on both, and then they have to be synced, and the syncing had to be done on the server. The other thing was when you use the deal or you save the deal, then you can only save that for 2 hours, and after 2 hours they have to be released. Yeah, and that couldn't be done on the client, so that also had to be done on the server. And the interesting thing was that without having a backend team, there was an iOS developer who had to do the backend, and he completely did it on his own, and he didn't install Eclipse or something else. He did it all on the website. And it worked out perfectly. And if we go to the next slide, here we can have a look. There are the apps, Android, iOS, and you see the website and backend. So we used four SDKs, the Android SDK, the iOS SDK, the PHP SDK for the website, who wasn't developed by us, who was developed by another company. And we also used the plain Java SDK for Google Web Toolkit dashboard for inserting the data. So there were four SDKs used, and we started, I don't know, with 5 or 10 classes in the beginning and the back end. And so there were a lot of iterations, always changing the data model on the server side. And always if something changed, we didn't do any big documentation or that. We only said to the front end guys, hey, just go into and download a new SDK. And so they always had the actual SDK with all the data models in there, and they know what to do. And there were only 2 or 3 lines of documentation if something changed. So that really saved us a lot of time, not only having no backend team, but only but also have less communication overhead. Yeah, and that's now please close your eyes if you don't want to see marketing. Backend as a service is, with that thing, so much cheaper than self-made backends. And go to the next slide. Yeah, and that's what differentiates us from the competitors. If you have a look at the market, and probably you will if you're interested in that, you will see some other guys. And what we think is special about us, we host in Germany, and yeah, as we have talked to a lot of people for using that thing, many clients have the requirement that the data has to be in Germany. We offer service level agreements for all paid plans that you normally don't get without being a big enterprise. And we have those generated SDKs that we've talked a lot about. Okay. So that's what we wanted to talk about. You feel free to contact us and feel free to ask questions.